You found a place to belong here in the Circle of Friends. I'm Missy, and today I'm with my good friend Libby. Libby, welcome back.
Hey, Missy, it's always so good to be here with you. And I know even walking in here and talking about, hey, what direction do we want to go in? And as we prayed, and you know, it's so easy to think about a particular direction and then think, oh, we're probably going to get sidetracked or whatever. But then you reminded me, you know, we're not here to be theologians. Yeah. We're here to just open the Word of God.
Yeah.
And I think my words to you were, I don't know if I'm prepared to dig into this passage. But then it's like, are we ever?
Are we ever, really? What the preparation really is an open heart.
That's exactly it.
A teachable spirit, mm-hmm. a willingness to say, God, what do you have for me here? What can I learn? What do you want to teach me now?
Yep.
And the thing that always strikes me, and I know we've said this over and over, maybe we sound like broken records on the radio, but God just takes us in places that we really didn't see coming.
Yeah.
Even around this table in this short half hour that we have. And it's so fun to see how he works and moves. And we think we have a plan, and mm-hmm. all of a sudden we're not going where we thought we were going at all. And where we end up is much better than where we had planned to go. So when I come to the table, I truly just come with an open heart and mind and say, Lord, I know you're going to lead us. I know you're going to guide us and direct us. And when we open your word, you will have something for us.
Oh, absolutely.
So listeners, we just encourage you in that. When you open God's word, there is something there for you. It doesn't have to be a deep spiritual, theological thought or a study of a doctrine, or maybe it's just one thing that God gives mm-hmm. you. But mm-hmm. that one thing is exactly what you need for life and living and to walk out in faith. And mm-hmm. I think that's the encouragement of reading God's word, is that he meets us there.
Oh, yeah.
Wherever we are.
Yeah. And I think, too, another beautiful thing is if we take some time to pay attention to what we are in need of in any particular moment, and I'm not saying to dwell on that, but to just say, hey, here's where I'm struggling. And then we go into the Word of God. It is amazing how something from where we're reading is going to meet that struggle, is going to address that, is going to speak to that. That has happened to me so many times. It doesn't necessarily solve the struggle, but it lets me know God is with me yeah. in this, through this, whatever this is, and whatever the outcome looks like. And I know, too, in our opening prayer this morning, you said, you asked the Lord to open the hearts of our listeners, even though we don't know who they are, open the minds. And then you said, and Lord, open the hearts of Libby and me. That's it, Missy.
Yeah.
You're right. That is it. And when I say I don't feel prepared, I know what you're saying as far as the heart issue. I'm always prepared to go into the Word mm-hmm. of God if my heart is prepared.
If your heart is prepared. And if you, and we're not talking about emotion. I want to make that really clear to our listeners. Because I think sometimes we get that confused. Like,
mm-hmm. I don't feel like this.
I don't feel like it, so I must not.
Right.
If in your mind you are willing and you want to, even if you don't feel like it, that's a prepared heart. God can work with
mm-hmm.
that. Do you know what
mm-hmm.
I'm saying?
Yes,
sometimes we have an expectation of where we should be, which is kind of ludicrous when you think about it. God knows us intimately. He knows us when we're not there.
mm-hmm.
When we're struggling, what we're struggling mm-hmm. with, he understands it even better than we do. So to try to dress ourselves up or clean ourselves up before we come to the Lord, either for salvation or in relationship with him or to the Word of God, or to just throw up our hands and say, well, I failed at that, so now I'm going to back off because God can't have anything to do with me.
Mm-hmm.
No, we should run straight to him, you know, muddy clothes and all.
Yeah.
You know,
we should
run toward him and say, help me. I am in desperate need of help here, regardless of what that, because we all go through times of doubt. We mm-hmm. go through times of fear. We go through times of anxiety. Sometimes we are on that mountaintop and that's an awesome place to be, but we can't stay up there either. So circumstances change, but God never changes.
Mm-hmm.
And he's always in the business of transforming us. So if we are willing, he can work with that. That's mm-hmm. all he needs a willing servant. He needs mm-hmm. somebody who has the want to. Mm-hmm. And he'll work you through the rest of it.
Yeah. Oh, that is such a good way to say it. Someone who has the want to, and he will work you through the rest of it. It's kind of like a child reaching up to a parent to take their hand and just being willing to be led across the street or through the store or wherever, to just be willing to be led. And that's all that he's asking of us. And you know, the beautiful thing is, even when we're not willing, he is always still there, nudging. And isn't it amazing? That's what makes me, I can't fully grasp his amazing grace, but that's what makes me ponder it more, is when I think that no matter what I do or don't do, he will never leave me nor forsake me.
Even when we think, well, where is he? I can't feel him or see him or sense him, or my prayer's hitting the ceiling.
Right.
That's emotion speaking. That's circumstance speaking. That's us. That's not him. Yeah. He is there. Or when, you know, when we fail, and I failed in my Christian walk. I failed to do the things that I know to do. That's what I mean by failure. Like, Missy, you know better.
Yeah.
And I get down on myself, and I hate that. And so part of me wants to run and hide, you know, like Adam and Eve in the garden. What did they do? You know, but that's not what God wants. God was still in the garden, wasn't he?
Yes.
He was still seeking them. He still wanted them. And what he wanted from them was for them to realize their need.
Yeah.
And that's what he's still asking of us today. What is it you need? Because I can give it to you.
Oh, isn't that so beautiful?
It is beautiful. And it's something I need to remind myself, because I do get down on myself sometimes and think, oh, you should do better. You could do better. And I'm not saying that's not a true statement, but at the same time, I can't allow that to make distance between me and God.
Right.
I need to go to God with that and say, God, I messed up.
Yes.
I failed at that. I know I can do better. Would you help me do better? I don't feel like I can do better because I keep messing up, but can you help me?
Right.
And
right.
He's right there.
Yeah.
He's right there.
That's his desire for you, is to do better, but knowing that we cannot do that of ourselves. We just can't. And sometimes our mess ups can then show us how much we need God.
Yeah.
We cannot do anything in and of ourselves that's of any value, really. And I think of our own children. Missy, when they messed up, did we want them to hide their head in shame?
No.
And not be able to go on from there? Did we want them to live in that? No. We were desperate for them to be able to be picked up and enabled to move on from that. Now, yeah, there needs to be repentance. There needs to be recognition. But then to be able to be equipped from that mess up, to go forth with no shame. And that is what we want for our kids.
Yeah.
And that's how much more does God want that for us?
Absolutely. And I go back to the scripture that says there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. So if you have a relationship with Jesus, the difference is we take a broken fellowship and call it, and we condemn ourselves, you know.
Yes.
We call a relationship broken, but it's not the relationship that's broken. It's the fellowship.
Oh, very good.
It's the sweetness and intimacy with Christ, the times that you spend with God. And that's when, if we back away, God hasn't backed away. He's never moved. You know, we may back away from him, but he never backs away from us, ever. And to remember that and to teach ourselves to run toward him in our worst moments, especially because that shows us our need. In our best moments, my prayer is, let me remember how much I need you, even when it's great, you know?
Yes.
Even when it's awesome, let me remember how desperately I need you in those moments. Because it's so easy not to think, I was going to say not to need God, but that's not true, to think that we don't need him. Do you know what I'm saying?
Oh, I do.
I got it covered, so why would I bother God with this
attitude? I do. And you know, earlier when you talked about the want, like God saying to us, what do you want me to do for you? And I thought of that's exactly what Jesus said to blind Bartimaeus. You know, he didn't just look at him. He already knew his need. He absolutely knew his need. But he allowed Bartimaeus to express that. Well, I want to see. I want to see. And how beautiful that Jesus already knew what he was going to do for Bartimaeus, but that Bartimaeus could see that he needed Jesus completely. And he was willing to say, this is what I want. I'm going to answer you. This is what I want. Isn't that beautiful? We want our kids to do that. God wants us to do that, to tell him what we want, to tell him what we need, and then to pay attention to how he is developing that, engaging with that, because it's not always yes.
This is true.
Not always yes. But oh my, now my mind is just going all over the place to so many scriptures.
I know, you know, we did have a plan. We had a good plan. But I want to go back to the scripture that I mentioned, and I'm going to read this portion.
Okay, good, good, good.
Because as we are sitting here talking about it, it does seem the direction we're going in for this moment. So I don't want to take this out of context. There's always more to a verse than sometimes what I pull out of my memory bank. But Romans 8:1 says, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. And I'm reading this out of the King James because this is how I memorized it. But it goes on to say, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. So it's more than just saying, oh, well, I'm not condemned. I can do whatever I want. And that's exactly what this whole passage and you know, Romans 7, Romans 8, that's what it's all about. It's Paul telling us, hey, wait a minute, don't just go out. It's like, okay, well, my dad's the chief of police. I can do whatever I want because, you know, he's not going to throw me in jail because what?
Yeah.
Or whatever. It's like taking advantage or thinking we aren't accountable, but we are. We are accountable in our part. I mean, Jesus has taken care of the whole part, and we do have eternal life. But how that, what that looks like and how that we walk that out on earth, there are some things on our part to do. So I don't want people to misunderstand when I just throw that out there. But let me read this whole passage because it's one of my favorites. Again, there's therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God, sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace, because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then, they that are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. And I'm going to stop there because maybe some of our listeners are like, whoa, especially in the language that I've read that in. But really, it's talking about, first of all, do you have a relationship with Christ?
Right.
If you do, then you have the Holy Spirit within you, and you are to be walking after the Spirit, not as the flesh. It's talking about that new creation, that new man. If any man is in Christ, he is a new creation. Mm-hmm. So there's a transformation that's taken place there. And one of the reasons why I love this is because when I read this, I am comforted and reminded that even I can't mess this up. I mean, I can mess up, right?
Yeah.
You know, 1 John tells us we have a way. When we sin, we confess, God forgives. But I cannot mess this thing up. And so when I'm down on myself or I see that I'm not being who I want to be or who I know I should be, God's already made provision for that. And I'm really struggling in trying to express that, but I hope you understand what I'm getting at. Like, no matter how badly I mess up, God has already made provision for me for that mess up.
Oh, yes,
now,
absolutely.
As Paul says, I mean, it's not that we should go and do whatever we want. No, that's not what he's saying. But he's saying when you do, you know, when you do find yourself, I don't want to say measuring up, but failing at what you know to do. You know, when you're not on the right path, then God has provided you a way to get back on the right path, like instantaneously, like in a heartbeat. Stop right now. Say, I'm not on the right path. God, I see that. I'm turning around. Help mm-hmm. me. And it mm-hmm. then and you're done. I mean, it's just really that simple and that complicated.
That's right. Oh, I hear you. I do. And this is so beautiful. And I think of what comes before it, especially since right there in Romans 8, verse 1, the word therefore is used. Mm-hmm. So, and we know this when we go back to chapter 7, Paul is really digging into that. Why do I do the things I know I shouldn't? And why do I not do the things I know I should? And he is bringing to us the very reality of that
struggle,
yeah. that tension yeah. between our flesh and our spirit. And he's not excusing any of it. He's acknowledging it. And he is saying to all of us, we are all in this together. This is going to strike you, maybe not in the same way it strikes me, but it is. And we need to realize, as you've said, Missy, that as long as we're living and walking on this earth, we are still going to have that struggle with spirit and flesh. And really, it comes down to which one are we going to feed? Mm-hmm. Which one are we going to nurture? And those are our choices. That's on us. Which one am I going to feed? But here's the beautiful thing. If we end up feeding the wrong one and getting off course, you told us, and God tells us, he is still right there. Yeah. He will never leave us, never forsake us. We just turn around and acknowledge it, and boom, we're back. And the other thing is, if we don't get it for a while and we stray off that path, and you know, scripture tells us that we can become kind of calloused then to that and not recognize it, God is still pursuing us.
Yeah.
And he pursues us by any means, really, other people. If you have people that have tried to, you know, help you get back on the right path, Listen to them. Hey, we need to take a break, don't we?
We do.
So let's do that, and we'll come right back and jump back into the Word of God. Thanks for being here with us today in the Circle of Friends.
Are you bored deciding what to wear each morning? Let the experienced team at the Village Barn Boutique revamp your wardrobe. With an ever-increasing selection, you are guaranteed to find the perfect piece. Located in the heart of Amish country on State Route 39 in Berlin, Village Gift Barn, never ordinary, we promise.
If there's a shortcut, I'd have found
We're back here in the Circle of Friends. I'm Libby, here with Missy, and we have been in Romans chapter 8, not necessarily intentionally, but that's kind of where we landed with the Lord's leading. And Missy, before the break, we were talking about just the beauty of God never leaving us or forsaking us. And even if we get off that path of pursued righteousness, we are righteous in Christ. Mm-hmm. If we are in Christ, He has made us righteous. His shed blood has made us righteous. But we can get off that daily righteous path pretty easily, and God is still in the process of pursuing us. And it really took me to something you had referenced earlier, which is 1 John. And I'm going to pick it up in verse 8. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Now I'm going to stop right there. Earlier, again, before the break, I mentioned that if we go in our own direction long enough, we can become pretty calloused mm-hmm. and cold and maybe not even recognize where we are anymore mm-hmm. and wake up one day and say, wow, how did I get here? Well, part of that is the deception of saying we have no sin. We'd never say that, but we live like it.
Right, right.
And then I think we can get to the place where we no longer recognize sin as sin the way we used to.
Right.
Like, we'll start calling things okay.
We'll justify. Yeah. Yeah. I think, and that is deception when we begin to justify things.
Right. And I know that earlier I mentioned that maybe friends have pursued you to help you to get back on track. And if you're not ready for that, that's a very, very hard, hard thing. But speaking from personal experience, I just want to say, receive it. Receive it. Even if they're not doing it well, receive it. There are times when I wish I would have received correction way before I did. Mm. And it would have made it so much less traumatic, I guess. But the beautiful thing is that God still takes that experience and uses it to shape us and transform us into His likeness more. And sometimes the more heavily you hang your head in shame, which He does not want us to do, the higher He lifts it, though, mm-hmm. because that's what He wants for us. And so again, we're not saying hang your head in shame. What we are saying is confess and repent. And so we can go on in 1 John. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Mm. If we say we have not sinned, we make Him a liar, and His word is not in us. Now, these verses, listeners, are not verses to cause you to feel shame. They are verses to cause you to feel need, like, wow, I need to know that I'm doing this God's way so that He is able to do what's best for me. Mm. This is all about God doing what's best for us. And you mentioned it earlier. When we sin, when we go our own way, we break the fellowship. We don't break the relationship, but we break the fellowship. And then we kind of tie God's hands as far as working in a way that's best for us. And yet the beautiful mystery of that is He's always at work. And so when we do come around, we see, oh my goodness, God brought me here. God brought me to this place of repentance. God brought me to this place of deliverance again. Mm. He did it. I did nothing except finally allow Him to open my eyes.
Yeah, it's as if, I mean, visually I can see it walking along the path together, and we're the ones that veer off the path.
Right.
And He's the one that has to reach out and grab us, you know, by the hand and try to bring us back. But He's not going to yank us back.
Right,
we have to come willingly. His hand is just held out to us like, come on, come this way. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, and we often use the illustration of a child. And, you know, you do try little toddlers. You try to give them as much freedom as you can in terms of, okay, you can walk. But if you don't listen to me, then, you know, you're going to be a little bit more restricted. You're going to have to hold my hand. You know, some people have resorted to putting the little backpacks on, so because they run off.
Oh, my daughter has three yeah. backpacks with leashes on them.
I mean, and you know, and I've heard people have trouble with that, but it's not trouble if you've got kids that run off and you know that their safety depends on you having a hold of them. And especially you got three kids and two hands, what are you going to do with that? You know, but it is that idea of God wants us to learn to walk with Him. But when we don't, He's going to try to gently coax us back. He's not going to force us into any of those decisions. But it is His love that pursuing us. It's just amazing because, as you said, Libby, it's not us that wakes up one day and say, oh, we fixed it. We got ourselves right. Mm-hmm. No, we can't even do that. That's all God's love in pursuing us and getting us back on the right track. And He will do that like right now.
Yeah.
Like wherever you're at right now, you can get back on God's path right now with a simple prayer. Now, that doesn't mean there won't be consequences along the way because of choices that you've made. That is absolutely true for all of us. But oh my goodness, the freedom in that and the love that's expressed in that, that God is right there, right now, ready, waiting, willing to reach out to us.
Okay, I love, love, love what you're saying, Missy, and it leads me right to Psalm 139. Mm. But before I say that, and I know we're coming close to the end of our day here, I want to go back to a vision that came to me when we were talking about the whole God reaching out His hand and holding our hand and a mother with toddlers and all that. I had to think of the whole backpack and leash thing. And of course, when people do that, they don't start out with that. They start out with holding their child.
Right, exactly.
Then they might be holding their hand.
Yes.
And then when you put, it's so beautiful to see when you put the backpack with the leash on them, you're helping that child to self-regulate, like recognize what their boundaries are. You're giving them some independence, but they know, oh, mom can rein me in here if she needs to. You're teaching them what boundaries are for their own good.
Yes.
And I'm like, isn't that so like God? He holds us. Then He holds our hand. Then He kind of lets us go a little bit, but He's always there to pick us up and hold us if we need it. And then you talked about how we can't even really, without God, acknowledge what we need and where we've gone wrong. And I love Psalm 139 at the very end. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. It all comes down to what God does and our response to that. Mm. That's beautiful. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, listeners, for joining us. You found a place to belong here in the Circle of Friends.
Thanks to generous donations, this program is produced by Circle of Friends Ministries. You can write to us at P.O. Box 345, Berlin, Ohio 44610, or contact us at 330-852-0000. You've found a place to belong.